So I'll be talking to you about losses to arbitrageurs of liquidity on automated market makers. Yeah, this is joint work with Andrea Canidio. He works at Cow Protocol, and I myself am at ETH Zurich in the Distributed Computing Group. Yeah, so what are automated market makers and why are we interested in them? So automated market makers are used on decentralized exchanges, which allow users to exchange tokens on a blockchain, exchange one cryptocurrency for another. And as you can see in this headline, they have been pretty popular, pretty successful, I would say, with several trillions of dollars traded on them. And while this might be small compared to traditional finance, it's definitely something interesting or something big we should look at. So how do they work, or how does market making in general work? Well, let's assume you totally hypothetically go to a scientific conference in Singapore and you want to exchange some of your euros for Singapore dollars. Then you could look for a second traveler somewhere who wants to exchange the tokens with the currencies with you, but it will probably be hard to find somebody who wants to do it at the same time and the same amount, right? And this is a place where market makers generally come into play. And they offer to buy and sell at any point, and they offer to buy and sell both directions, basically. And of course, they offer prices so that they make a slight profit from this. And maybe you also saw it at the airport. There are sometimes these exchanges there, which are also market makers, just very uncompetitive. And I suggest you never use them. Anyway, so in a traditional marketplace, I would say, for example, for stocks, for foreign exchanges, for also cryptocurrencies on centralized exchanges, the normal mechanism that is used is an order book. So we have all these market makers telling us for what they want to buy and sell, and everything is put into an order book. And then if you want to make an order, you get the best offer from this order book. So for automated market makers, what I'm talking about today, this works slightly differently. So there the idea is all liquidity providers, so these were previously the market makers, they put all their liquidity into one pool. So the two currencies are now in one pool. And this pool then has an algorithm, short piece of code that decides at which price it wants to buy and sell. And the most simple automated market maker is the constant product one. It's also, interestingly, the probably most used one. And as the name says, it only allows you to make a trade if you leave the product in the pool constant. And of course, you need to pay a trading fee on top. So first, some of your trade goes as a fee to the pool, to the liquidity providers. And after that, you need to leave the product constant. But we'll get back to that later. So if we first just look at the constant product, we have this example, 200 tokens A, 100 tokens B. And now you want to buy 10 units of B from the pool. So only 90 are left, and then the pool will need 222 to keep the product constant, so you will get a price of 2.22 here in this example. If you only want to buy one token B, then you get a better price of 2.02, and if you want to sell one token B to the pool, then you get a price slightly below 2. And in general, what we can say here is that the market price in this situation is 2. So the pool is willing to buy small amounts slightly above and sell small amounts slightly below. And in general, if somebody else in the market believes the price should be higher, they can buy from this pool and move the price, or if they think it should be lower, they can sell to the pool and also change the pool. So now we assume we're in a situation across markets, across participants, everybody believes the price, market price is 2. And now something changes. The market price changes to 3.1, for example. This could be a change on a centralized exchange like Binance, or just new information making token B more valuable. Then, of course, the AMM here is still quoting the old price. It's still selling for around the price of 2. So it needs to be rebalanced. In particular, the ratio now needs to be 3.1. And the trade to be made here is the one you see here. And the important thing is this trade is being made at a price of 2.5. And this is the key problem, maybe, or the key observation we make here, that these AMMs, in order to be rebalanced to the new to a new market price, they make a trade at a lower or worse price from the point of view of the pool. And that means there is a difference here. So if I'm an arbitrageur and the market price is now 3.1 on a centralized exchange, for example, I can make this rebalancing trade for 2.5 and sell this on the centralized exchange, and I will make a profit. And this profit comes at a loss to the pool, of course, which is then a loss to the liquidity providers. And this is exactly what we measure in this paper. And just to be clear, so this is not anything we invented or we defined. This is has been formalized as loss versus rebalancing, for example, by Miliones and others, or also as predictable loss. And just to maybe emphasize again what we're looking at here, so these are by design losses to arbitrageurs, meaning that AMMs in their current form can only be rebalanced to the current price by making these losses. If you are a market maker in an order book, if the market price changes, you can take out your orders, put them back in at the new market price without making these losses. So that's the fundamental difference or the fundamental problem with AMMs here. Secondly, they are in some sense preventable. So if you build your AMM differently, you won't have them. So that's why they're interesting if you're designing AMMs. And also they're in some sense a profitability measure for the liquidity provided in these AMMs. And I'll explain this a bit more now. So only because you're losing money to arbitrageurs doesn't mean as a liquidity provider yet that you lose money as a whole. Because assume you're providing liquidity with between Bitcoin and US dollars, then if the price of Bitcoin goes up and you measure your value in USD, in US dollars, then your value will also go up, like on the left here, or it will go down if Bitcoin goes down. But you will, in both cases, definitely have less money compared to the case where you had not made these losses to arbitrageurs. And on a high level, you can then say that your return or your profit and loss as a liquidity provider would be some market risk. This would be the Bitcoin going up and down. You lose something to arbitrageurs, but then again, you earn something from trading fees. And if we look at this, we can think that as a liquidity provider, if I'm taking this market risk, I would like to have a positive return, right? So in particular, this red part here should be positive and fees should be larger than these arbitrage losses. And these are exactly the two things we measure in our study to see what is actually the case in practice. And to measure the arbitrage losses, we simulate these liquidity pools. And in particular, we simulate them being rebalanced to the Binance price in every block of the blockchain. And here, so the Binance prices are actual historical cryptocurrency prices. And on the other hand, we look at how many or how much fees are actually historically earned in these AMM pools. And there we look at Uniswap pools, which is the biggest. I think, depending on how you measure, about 50% of the market. And we look at full range liquidity position. This is only important if you know what concentrated liquidity and Uniswap V3 is. If not, just ignore it. Okay. So then as a result, we get for all liquidity pools curves like this. So for example, this is ETH and USDT, one of the biggest liquidity pools. And we find over 2 years, so we looked at 2022 and 2023, they made about 12% from fees, but actually they lost slightly more to arbitrageurs in that time. So according to our metric, or according to this metric, that would mean they were not profitable. And we actually find this is the case for many of the largest pools. So these are the ETH and Bitcoin stablecoin pools. And for most of them, you see the lines going down here. And since we're plotting fees minus arbitrage losses, that means they're losing more to arbitrageurs than they're making in fees. And this is definitely something remarkable, I would say, because there are several hundreds of millions of dollars in these pools, which are apparently not profitable according to this metric. Then we also looked at different pools, smaller cryptocurrencies, smaller pools, where some are profitable, some are not. And then we found another interesting aspect that there are actually pools that are pretty profitable. And these are Uniswap V2 pools. So Uniswap, this is the older version of Uniswap that is still running. Uniswap V3 is the newest version. Yeah, and they have, over these 2 years, made more than 10% of fees when you subtract these losses. And if you look at these pools side by side, so this is the same pool, ETH-USDT, the same fee, 0.3%, but one on Uniswap V3 and one on Uniswap V2, and you see they have the same arbitrage losses because it's the same price. The same price changes, but you see the V2 pool makes significantly more in fees. So there, the liquidity providers were actually profitable. And this is definitely interesting, I would say, because it shows some kind of market inefficiency, maybe, that either liquidity providers are not allocating capital optimally, or traders are not trading optimally. And so if anybody has an idea why this is happening, tell me afterwards. I have also some other ideas, but it takes too long to go into this now. Then the second thing we look at in this paper is how these arbitrage losses depend on the time between blocks. Because we've seen these are pretty significant, right? And so we might look for ways to prevent them. And one potential way is changing the block times of the blockchain. In particular, if we have shorter times between blocks, then also the price changes between these blocks are potentially shorter. And that means there will be less losses to the arbitrageurs, as I showed in the beginning. Yeah, so we did some measurements here. And we find relatively diverse behavior, maybe. So currently, Ethereum block times are 12 seconds. And if we go all the way down to 100 milliseconds, this is the smallest unit we test, we see that these losses could be reduced by, I think, 20 to 70%. But this is very different between different pairs. And another aspect, so we also looked in the different direction. What is if we have longer block times? Because this may be desirable for other reasons. Then we actually see at about 2 minutes, it seems to level off at about twice the current level. So that means we have about twice as, we would have about twice as much arbitrage losses with longer block times. And then just to mention, so this has actually already been studied theoretically, how these block times would impact arbitrage losses. And there the prediction was it would be a square root of the block time. And the empirical, our empirical data shows that this similar behavior, but I would say it doesn't go down as much as predicted theoretically with smaller block times, and also the leveling off effect is observable. And then maybe at the end, I just want to highlight another aspect which is not directly in this paper, but as we've seen these significant amount of losses, we might also think, why not change the AMM to stop this from the beginning, right? So I showed you this rebalancing trade would be made at a price where the trade price is different from the market price or the marginal price after the trade. So why don't we just change it, basically? The AMM can decide how it prices assets, right? We could do this. But the problem is then traders can split their trade into very small parts, each of them just pays the marginal price and only moves it a tiny bit, and in the end you actually end up at the same price as before. So this alone does not work, but what you can actually do is you can combine this with batching. So then you collect, for example, every all trades between one block, batch them together and execute them at one price. And then if you combine this with the adapted trading function, you have potentially a situation where the AMM does not trade or give away a profit, but trades at the market price after the trade. And this is, we've discussed this in a different paper. I'm just putting in here. And with this, I would just want to give you the main takeaways from our empirical analysis. So the first thing is these arbitrage losses on AMMs are very significant. They're in many cases even larger, higher than the fees the AMMs earn, and this for really big amounts of liquidity in these pools. Secondly, we find surprising differences between pools where some are profitable and some are not. And the effects of reducing block times are also very variable between the different pairs. Yeah, and so the top one is the paper I'm presenting today. The second one is our paper on how to design an AMM to prevent these losses. Feel free to take a look if you want to see more details. And of course, I'm also happy to answer questions now or later in the break. And with this, I thank you for listening.